Hello and welcome to the first webinar in the Organic Seed Production Webinar Series organized by the Organic Seed Alliance and the Multinational Exchange for Sustainable Agriculture. Our presenters today are Michaela Colley, Jared Zeistro, and Lori McKenzie of the Organic Seed Alliance, along with Leah Atwood and Natalia Pinzon-Jimenez of the MESA program. So without any further ado, I'm going to hand things over to our first presenter, who is Michaela Colley of the Organic Seed Alliance.
Thank you, Alice. Good morning. This webinar is the first of a series of six, as Alice said, and our intent is to follow seed producers through the production season and provide educational information along the way on topics pertinent to what you would be experiencing at this time of year in the field. Of course, it is June now, so many of you who are growing seed have thought about what you're going to plant, but we're going to walk folks through a little bit of the thought process in selecting which crops you would grow and planning out your field. So this webinar is a component of a larger project that's a partnership between Organic Seed Alliance and the Multinational Exchange for Sustainable Agriculture. And the goal of the project is to train beginning farmers in seed production, but the information is certainly meant for existing farmers who are moving into seed production as well. And one component of this larger project includes an internship program, which is a matchmaking internship between experienced seed producers and farm interns. And at the end of this webinar series, we're going to share a little bit of information about that internship program. And a number of those interns are actually attending the webinar, but we have a lot of folks online who are not part of that internship program. So if you're interested in learning more about the internship, stay on at the end, and if you are an intern, stay on and we will walk you through the website as well so you can see what sort of resources and how that matchmaking service works. Other components of this project are a number of educational resources that are available online through both eOrganic, Organic Seed Alliance's website, and through the internship website, and we'll show you those at the end of the talk today. In addition, there will be a number of workshops hosted on farms throughout this summer and next summer, and you can both visit the Seed Alliance website or the internship website for more information about the timing and location of those field opportunities, field trainings. And another component is, of course, the eOrganic webinar series that Alice already mentioned. And there will be five more webinars throughout the season covering topics ranging from how to conduct trials on your farm, how to manage pests and disease, how to harvest and manage seed quality, seed cleaning, and economics and contracting of seed. So we invite you all to join us once a month. So today we will talk about where do you start as a new seed producer. And just wanted to share with you some of the topics we're going to cover so you can see the trajectory of information being presented. We'll start out with Lori McKenzie from Organic Seed Alliance, sharing a little information about basic seed crop biology that must be considered in picking a crop appropriate for your operation, and how to consider which crops fit your climatic zone so that you can have the best success in producing quality seed. Then we'll turn it over to Jared Zeistro from Organic Seed Alliance, and he will talk a little bit more about how to approach the production planning, how to consider how much seed to grow, what market are you growing for, what kind of yield you might anticipate, and how do you consider how to lay that out in the field so that that you have the best seed quality and the best ease of harvest at the end of the season. He'll also share some resources on record keeping that can help with both the current year and future year planning. And then, as I mentioned, at the end of that process, we'll take some questions for a while, and then we'll come back to the webinar, and Leah Atwood and Natalia Pinzon-Jimenez from MESA will share more information about the internship program. With that, I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to Lori McKenzie.
Okay, good morning, everyone, probably afternoon for some. I imagine that some of the information I'm going to share with you will be very familiar, and I'm assuming there's a range of experience and expertise both in vegetative production and seed production among those of you who are on the webinar this morning. So just to make sure we're all on the same page to start, it's important to know whether you're dealing with an open pollinated crop or a hybrid crop in your seed production and seed saving. OP varieties, what I most often hear about an OP variety is it's a stable variety that breeds true from seed, which means if you save seed from an OP variety, the plants that grow from that seed will look like the plants that you saved them from. Hybrid seed is a little different. It's a varieties that are created by a controlled crossing of two parental types that are often very different from each other. So seeds saved from hybrids will not grow true to type, which just means the plants that grow from the seeds that you save will not look like the plants that you saved them from necessarily in most instances. It is not true that you can't save seed from a hybrid. In very few instances that will be true, but for the vast majority of crops and seeds you'll be working with, you can save seed from a hybrid. You'll just be embarking on a selection and breeding project rather than saving seed that looks like what you got your seed from. You'll hear this theme a lot throughout the webinar from both Jared and myself. Jared and I will probably tell you some of the same things, and that reiteration is to drive home some of the most important points that we really want you to take away from this webinar. And one of them is really knowing your crop that you want to produce and save, knowing your climate. In some instances, especially when you're dealing with crops that we harvest for fruit, like tomatoes and squashes and cucumbers and those types of fruited crops, saving seed from those crops and producing seed of those crops is very similar to producing the vegetative state that we harvest and sell and eat. Whereas for other crops, the greens, spinaches, brassicas, we harvest those in the vegetative production phase generally far before we get to any of the seed production phase. So it takes, for instance, maybe around 45 days to produce a head of lettuce, and it can take 120 to produce mature seed on a lettuce plant. So you need to know that you can produce that crop well, not only through the vegetative stage, but all the way through the whole life cycle of the seed production. And there are different requirements in that seed production phase than there are for the vegetative phase. So there's a lot of elements to consider there. And consider that you can produce it well on your farm for vegetative phase is not always the same question as can you produce good seed on it. Now that's to say if we go through these next series of slides and you say, oh, I'm not very well situated for producing seed on this crop I really want to produce seed on, you can of course do it in modified environments with high tunnels, greenhouses, row covers, and things like that. So just because you're not ideally suited to produce seed of a certain crop doesn't mean you aren't able to. Here are a few considerations to start out with. Isolation is a big one. You'll hear this from Jared too, especially in field planning. And open pollinated and self-pollinated versus cross-pollinated, excuse me, will be a major consideration in isolation. So if you're dealing with crops that are strongly cross-pollinated, you will need larger expanses of physical isolation. You can also isolate in time, depending on your season and what kind of environment you're growing in. And if you're dealing with things that are very self-pollinated, such as beans, peas, tomatoes, your isolation requirements are much less. And we'll come back to that as well in a little bit. And how many can you grow? Do you want to grow multiple seed crops in a year? Or do you want to focus on one seed crop per year and grow a large abundance of it and have either enough to fulfill a commercial contract or for your own use for a number of years. And again, this will come back to the self-pollinated versus cross-pollinated question, especially if you want to grow multiple crops of the same species. So if you're growing squashes, there are different species of squashes. If you're growing pepos and moschatas, you can grow those side by side. If you're growing brassicas and you're growing two different brassicas, if you're growing rapas and oleraceae, you can grow those side by side. But you can't grow multiples of the same type of brassica or squash and not have some crossing if you don't have geographic isolation. And you want to consider how the seed production will integrate into your existing system, especially if you're doing things like brassicas and greens, where the life cycle of the seed production is a different ballgame than the life cycle of the vegetative production. And something to consider that's a little bit hard to think of because it tends to be out there in the future are the harvest time demands and when this crop, the seed production, will come into maturity and how you're going to handle it. Will you need additional equipment or tools to harvest it, to dry it, to clean it, to store it? All things to think about before you start. A little bit of basic biology. Probably most of the seed production you'll be doing will be on annual plants, something we're all very familiar with. Most of our food production done on an annual cycle. But one thing to consider here that I want to point out is probably the most important piece of information on this slide is you have to plant these early enough to mature the seed. And again, that goes back to that you need your climate requirements and your environment needs to be suitable to that entire life cycle through the seed production, not just the vegetative production. You may want to do some biennial production. And the key to biennial production, these are your root crops, carrots, beets, some of the brassicas such as cabbage, cauliflowers. They need to overwinter because they need vernalization. And vernalization is an accumulation of cold. Generally, we say 8 to 10 weeks at about 50 degrees or less. It does vary depending on the crop species you're working with. But that's sort of a general requirement that will cover most of them. And vernalization does not mean you have to leave that crop out in the field. You can dig those root crops up and store them in a root cellar, a cold storage, or refrigerator, but you need somewhere to be able to store those roots and then plant them out the next spring. And that vernalization helps the plant transition from the vegetative phase to the reproductive phase. And if it doesn't get vernalization, the plant won't actually transition to the reproductive phase. And one thing to consider here is you're going to lose some during the winter. Not all of those roots are going to make it through the winter, and it's a great opportunity to do some selection. But you always want to grow a little more than you're going to need to end up with. So two slides here on pollination systems. I'm sure most of you are familiar with beans and peas being our most obvious self-pollinating crops, and there are biological mechanisms that help enforce this. The biggest one being fused flowers, fused parts of flowers. So any crop that is self-pollinating will always have perfect flowers, so it can accept and pollinate and fertilize itself. And one trick, if you are unsure whether the crop you're working with is self-pollinated or cross-pollinated, the anther and the stigma just are physically close in flowers that are self-pollinated. It's not a dead ringer that flowers with close anthers and stigmas will be close self-pollinated, but it's a great clue. And they can also trick you a little bit, and sometimes the petals of self-pollinated crops will open after they have fertilize themselves. Lettuce is a great example of this. Lettuce is strongly self-pollinated but has this beautiful little aster-like flower when it opens. So cross-pollinated crops on the other end of that spectrum tend to have more separation between the anther and the stigma. Some of them that are very strongly cross-pollinated, such as some of the brassicas, will have self-incompatibility where they won't accept their own pollen for fertilization. And sometimes some of these plants will actually have temporal separation where they're dehiscing their pollen and releasing pollen before the female aspects of the crop are actually ready to ensure that there's pollen around when those female parts emerge. Cross-pollinated crops tend to be copious pollen producers and have showier flowers than the sulfur. So again, not a dead ringer, but a good clue. So there's a lot of information on this slide, and this is to give you kind of an idea of there's a spectrum. Some things are very strongly self-pollinated, such as the peas and the lettuce, and some are very strongly outcrossed or cross-pollinated, like the brassicas, chenopods being the spinach. And spinach, if you're not familiar with it, is actually a dioecious crop. So if you grow a seed crop of spinach, you'll see male and female plants, not just male and female flowers on the same plant or perfect flowers on the same plant. And this is getting back to the concept of isolation and self-pollinated crops. The more strongly self-pollinated they are, the less isolation distance you need between them. On the opposite end of the spectrum, the more strongly cross-pollinated things are, the greater isolation distance you need, especially things that are wind-pollinated. Wind-pollinated crops produce copious amounts of pollen, which can travel miles if you live in a very windy and open area. And it's hard to nail down a seed producer or a plant breeder when you want to know exactly how many plants you need to produce seed from or how far they need to be away from each other, because of course there's a lot of factors. It's a natural system, and factors such as wind, the presence and abundance of pollinators, geographical barriers in landscape, trees, hills, how far you are away from neighbors who might be producing any seed. So the recommendations you see here on the slide are general recommendations that we feel are appropriate for maintaining quality and purity when you're doing seed production. And if you're doing seed production, of course, for a volume, for a commercial contract, or your own sales or your own seed saving, and for your own needs on the farm, you're probably going to do a lot more than these minimum recommendations. So getting into some climate issues, and I want to say, stop for a minute and say, on our website, on the OSA website, which is seedalliance.org, there are publications, and a few years ago we did one on regional or climate considerations for seed production. So all this information is accessible in that guide, and you just go onto our website and you can download a copy for free, which then you can keep on your computer or print out and take with you wherever you go. So one of the main considerations when you're doing seed production is thinking about temperatures, and temperatures at certain times during the life cycle of these plants. So knowing what the minimum and maximum temperatures are, your nighttime and daytime temperatures, when you get your timing of peak temperatures, and again, this is a little challenging for those of us who are growing crops as the climate is changing and things are shifting and seasons look a little different from year to year. So this makes seed production a little more challenging. And how long do you get periods of hot? Do you get short snaps of hot? Do you get short snaps of cold? There are some great models online for calculating heat units and doing growing degree day models. That's becoming more and more common, and there are more and more resources out there. There's some great modeling resources through Oregon State University if you're interested in playing with some of those numbers. The most important time to consider temperature in the seed production life cycle is during flowering. That's when the plants are essentially most vulnerable, and the pollen in particular and the stigma are most vulnerable, especially if you're dealing with cross-pollinated crops where those structures are exposed to wind, to heat. They can dry and desiccate. Things that like corn, that like humidity and warm temperatures that stay through the night, tend to be vulnerable if you live in an area that's really windy and dry, and pollen and the silks can get desiccated and your pollination and fertilization can suffer. In general, seed crops can handle a little more extreme temperature than they would like once they have gotten through the pollination and fertilization phase of their reproduction. This is a length of season we'll come back to in a few slides, and I'll give you sort of a region by region breakdown. But thinking about what is your length of season, both in terms of heat and dryness, rain, day length is an important consideration. There are crops that are day length sensitive. Spinach is a prime example. It will start bolting when you've got about a 15-hour day, fairly regardless of how big it is. So you need, if you're going to do spinach seed production, you need to live in a climate where the plants have time to get up out of the ground and grow to a sufficient size to have the frame and resources they need to produce quality, abundant seed. Mentioned rainfall, especially if you're doing any of the dry seeded crops and you need late summer, early fall that's fairly dry to get those seeds to maturity and get them out in the fields before the rains come, because you can get sprouting on the plant as well as disease incidents once that rain starts coming on into fall. Wind can be both your friend and your enemy. If you're dealing with wind-pollinated crops, you need wind to move that pollen around. If you live in a really still environment where you don't get a lot of air movement at the time of peak pollination, you're going to need to go out and help those plants get the pollen moved around. If you're dealing with plants that are really tall and you've got strong, persistent winds that you deal with throughout the summer, you may need to consider staking, where in other areas that crop may not need to be staked if there aren't persistent winds. So just to hammer home that temperature during pollination is really important, and you want to consider what your environment is and how that will work with the crops you're interested in producing. Do you have pollinators around? This is especially important if you're doing any environmental modification or structures for isolation. So if you're using pollination cages, or if you're using high tunnels, do you have pollinators around that you can manage naturally, or do you have a source to buy pollinators from, and do you know when you need to get them? We buy ours from Forked Tree Ranch. They're an excellent supplier of pollinators, and I strongly recommend them if that's something you'll need. And what you consider, especially if you're doing cages, buy pollinators that like pollinating your crop. Not all pollinators are great with all crops. So you can talk to producers of pollinators and do some research online as to which pollinators do well with which crops. There's a great publication by the Xerces Society, which I believe you can access through the Organic Seed Alliance website, called, I think it's Pollinator Management for Organic Seed Production, and it's a great resource on the different pollinators that are out there and which crops they work really well with. Another aspect to think about with wind is self-pollinated crops and cross-pollinated crops. We don't necessarily think of wind being important or helpful with self-pollinated crops, but it very much is. Even though the flowers and the biology and the structures of especially the strongly self-pollinated crops are set up for their own pollination and fertilization, they benefit greatly from a little air movement or even pollinator visits that come and shake those flowers up and help dehiss and move the pollen around inside of those confined structures. So if you are doing seed production inside of a high tunnel or a greenhouse and you don't have a lot of wind or air movement, fans can be really helpful. Even going through and physically just rustling the plants with your hands as you're walking up and down the aisles can vastly improve your seed set. And if you don't have enough rain and you're irrigating, think about what kind of irrigation are you doing, at what stage in the life cycle are you doing it. Overhead irrigation is fine when you're in the vegetative stage, but if you're working with any of the naked seed or dry seeded crops and you need to irrigate and you've got overhead irrigation during seed set and maturity, and you're exposing those seeds to a lot of humidity and potential for disease, potential for sprouting. So you want to think about using different system irrigation during different stages of the reproductive life cycle. So I've mentioned dry seeded crops a couple of times. Their counterpart are the wet seeded crops. The dry seeded crops are harvested like grains, and they need that seasonal dry, especially in late summer and early fall. And they do best in low humidity environments. They like it dry. They tend to get more disease in high humidity environments and are challenged by that. And they're susceptible to disease at maturity because they're not protected by a fruit, and they're fairly vulnerable. On the other side of that, the wet-seeded crops are harvested generally as fruits. They're usually harvested with some sort of water extraction. So if you're doing any large volume of wet-seeded crops, this is an example where you may want to look at equipment or tools, especially if you're doing winter squash, where you've got to smash open a lot of rigid fruits and deal with a lot of internal pulp. How are you going to do that? Talk to the people who've done it. Watch videos. There's some great information out there, some great resources. But that's something to consider, as well as the time, as well as the equipment that's needed for that. It's easier to avoid diseases with wet-seeded crops at maturity because they're protected by the fruits. So we break down the sort of our regional crop production into four regions. And the first one are the cool-seeded dry season crops. These are things that like it when it's cool and wet in the spring, and they don't like it very hot when it's flowering. And when they're just starting to set seed, they prefer the temperatures to be 75 degrees or less. They can handle gentle rains and wind in the summer, and they like that dry weather in the late summer and early fall. Some examples of these kind of crops, and you will notice there's a little overlap between some of these regions, and it's not that one crop can only be grown in one region. There are some that will do well in multiple regions, and again, as I mentioned at the outset, you can always do some environmental modification to some degree and grow these crops in regions that are not specified as their ideal. So the chenopodes do great in these kind of areas. Your spinach, beets, Swiss chards, brassicas do great. You notice most of these are greens. You've got some of those biennial root crops like the parsnips with the beets. And these areas are similar to the Salish Sea. That's up where we are here in Port Townsend, Washington, up on the Olympic Peninsula. And cooler regions, generally maritime regions. The next one are warm season dry seeded crops. These are very similar to the cool season crops. They just like a little bit warmer weather. They like a little bit more variable weather in the spring. They generally do better if the weather's a little bit drier, a little bit warmer, the summers are warmer. They like a little bit warmer temperatures for flowering and early seed development. They still like to be under 85, so they can tolerate about 10 degrees warmer in general than the cool season crops. And these take a little longer to mature. They need a longer season and a longer rain-free period into that late summer, early fall. Now here's some of the examples, some of the same crops we saw in the cool season dry seeded list. And these areas, not surprisingly, are moving down here on the West Coast into the warmer areas of Southwest Washington. The Willamette Valley of Oregon is a prime place for a lot of these crops. And then valleys. And then we get to the hot season dry seeded crops. These are crops that need it really warm in the spring. They need to be irrigated early. And when they get into the flowering and seed set production, they like it pretty hot. And they like it hot into the summer and also through the night, as well as during the day. They also need it dry in the late summer and off until the fall. You notice this is a theme of seed production. It's really nice to live in areas where we have long seasons and dry falls, because it gives us the opportunity to mature seed and dry it down outside. These are getting into some of different crops. You don't really see so much overlap with the warm and cool season crops. Here you're getting more into your beans, your alliums, carrots, onions, sweet corn, and these are areas that are obviously hotter and drier across the nation. And finally, we've got hot season, wet-seeded crops, and these like warm nights in the spring and summer, and this is pretty important for pollen growth. When the pollen lands on the stigma, the pollen tube grows down the style in order to fertilize the ovary, and the humidity holds the heat through the evening, so you've got nice warm days, but you've also got warm nights for that pollen growth to continue into the night, and that's where you're going to get your best fertilization from these also. So that high humidity isn't always for the need of fruit development, it's really for holding the temperature and keeping it nice and warm throughout both the day and night. And you can, of course, do these under drier conditions, and you will still be able to achieve seed set and quality seed production. You just might not get as much as you would if you grew them in the higher humidity environments. Not surprisingly, these are our fruits, such as the cucumbers, melons, squash, tomatoes. In this class of things, the squash, cucumbers, and melons, the cucumbers like it a little bit on the cooler side. They like to be more in that sort of moderate to high 70s within the Solanaceae family. The tomatoes, eggplants, and peppers. The tomatoes like it a little bit cooler than eggplants and peppers do. They like to be in the low 80s if possible during that pollination and early seed set time. And these are some of the areas, the warmer, more humid areas of the states where seed production for these types of crops is really prime. So with that, I am going to hand it over to Jared and let him continue with some planning and production. And I wish you all well on your journeys and your endeavors in seed production.
All right. Thank you, Lori. So I'm Jared Zeistro, and I'm going to spend the next 20 minutes or so going over some of the basics of how to plan your seed crops. So ultimately, a big part of what will help you succeed as a seed grower, whether you're doing that for your own farm or for your on contract for a seed company, will be good planning. So some of the things that are part of a good planning process include thinking about what you can grow along the lines of what Lori talked about, but also how much should you grow, where can you grow it on your farm, and when should you plant it. So we'll start by going over again what you can grow, and I think Lori covered this pretty well, so I'll keep it fairly brief. As Lori described, the environment is really a key factor in determining what you can grow. And as she pointed out, there are ideal environments for many crops, but there's also many times when you can grow crops in your climate, even if they're more marginal. However, keeping in mind that if you're growing crops in climates that are slightly more marginal for them, that the yields can be lower, and also that the risks of crop failure or poor germinating seed can be higher. So if the crop is important enough to you, or the value of the seed is high enough, you can still be worth it to grow those crops, but you should be wary of producing large lots of seeds of crops that might be marginal in your environment if you don't have a lot of experience growing them and are unsure of whether or not they'll be successful. So the second factor in choosing what crops to grow, again, is isolation. And as Lori detailed, different crops have different isolation requirements. When considering what crops to grow, you need to ask yourself a few questions. First, do I have isolation from flowering crops of the same species growing on my neighbor's land? In other words, will these my seed crops potentially cross with seed crops or flowering crops that are growing on my neighbor's land? Do I have isolation from from other seed or even non-seed crops of that species on my farm, if they might, if you have crops that are not necessarily being grown for seed but may accidentally flower at the same time as your seed crops on your farm. For example, can you, and I've seen this in close at hand, can you be sure that you'll be able to till in your baby leaf spinach patch before it starts to bolt and flower if it's in too close of proximity to your spinach that you're growing for seed? Finally, are there weeds in my area that are the same species and can potentially cross? For example, in many parts of the region of the country, we have Queen Anne's lace, which is the same species as carrots, and it could cross if it is in growing in close proximity to your seed crops. Also keeping in mind that you may be able to grow a seed crop, but only have isolation for one variety of that species on your farm. And if the crop is important enough to you, you might be able to isolate it using cages, for example. So if you don't have the actual physical isolation, you can come up with potentially another plan to create isolation, as Lori said. But again, it would need to make sense to you in terms of the importance to go through the added effort to do caging. So the other thing to think about is, do you have the skill set necessary to successfully grow that crop? Every crop may require different skills to produce, to harvest, and to clean. Have you grown this crop before? What scale have you grown it before? If this crop is a new crop for you, then you need to be thinking about starting small and treating it as a trial run potentially rather than considering it as a big part of your farm livelihood. Finally, do you have specialized tools that allow you to easily produce, harvest, and clean your seed? Some seed crops can be grown and harvested and processed with some very straightforward tools, and others, depending on the scale that you're growing on, may greatly benefit from more specialized tools. So knowing that will help you determine what makes sense to grow on your farm. So once you have an idea of some of the crops that could be grown on your farm, the next step in the planning process is to think about how much to grow. So first you want to understand what the market for your seed will be. Where will the seed be going? Will it be sold? Will it be used by yourself for your own farm, on-farm use? A seed grower, Frank Morton, once told me that it is very easy for beginning seed growers to grow way more seed of a variety than there's demand for. The challenge really is to fill up your farm with the right amount of enough varieties that all have some sort of market. So if you're selling your seed via, say, seed packets and seed racks, can you estimate how much you'll need to supply yourself? Keeping in mind that many seeds are viable germinate well for multiple years in storage. Will you be selling the seed on a contract? And if so, if you're selling it on a contract to a seed company, is there some degree of overage allowed? In other words, if you produce more seed than your contract stipulates, will the seed company buy that extra seed, and how much extra will they buy? Keep in mind that though aiming and successfully meeting your contract, your contracted seed amounts is a really important and helpful way to build a long-term reputation as a reliable seed grower. You don't want to consistently produce way too much seed that doesn't have a market just to ensure that you have enough. So once you have an idea of how much seed you want, where it's going to be marketed, it's time to work backwards from those totals to think about how much space you want to plant for a given lot of seed that you're going to be producing. So the first step in this is to have an estimate of seed yields. And this is something that can be extremely challenging because there's not a lot of information out there about seed yields, and seed yields can vary tremendously between varieties in a given species and between locations. So how do you get that info? The best place is through your own research and knowledge. So this leads to an important point that investing in research on your farm is really one of the things that will help you succeed in the long run as a successful, productive seed grower. So what I mean by that is, for example, in addition to what you might consider to be your bread and butter seed production, the contracts and crops that you're planning on paying the bills with, also keep some amount of space and time allocated towards smaller contracts or even your own personal trials of crops that you may not have enough, a lot of experience with growing in your area, but you're considering for the potential production in the future. These trials and small productions can yield information that will really strengthen your planning and help you succeed in the long run. So if you don't have your own experience and research to help you estimate yield, then the second best place is going to be from other growers. So ideally these would be producers that are relatively close to you in your region that have climates that are similar. And if you're lucky enough to have other seed growers in your region, ask them what kind of yields they've gotten on the variety that you're planning on growing, or at least on similar varieties in the same species. How variable were those yields for them? That will give you a sense of how much variability you might expect in your seed crops. You can also, outside of local seed growers, it often pays to, if you're contracting with a seed company, contact them and ask them if they're willing to put you in touch with some of the people who've grown that variety for them in the past, or who have grown similar varieties for them in the past, and get them on the phone and ask them their experiences in terms of how that variety yielded for them, and as well as any other important tips and tricks they might have in terms of successfully producing those varieties. The final place that many seed growers will turn to is the Knott's Handbook. And this is a classic book that has a table in it with some very rough and frankly fairly optimistic yield estimates for a handful of crops, but can give you at least a baseline if you don't have any other information. One of the things at Organic Seed Alliance that we've seen is that there is this gap in information around seed yield. So we have some proposals in right now, and hopefully we'll be able to get some support to compile and distribute more seed yield information to help more growers succeed. So once you have an idea of the amount of seed you need and the estimated yields, you can use this to estimate how much area you need for each seed crop. So in front of you is an example spreadsheet that was provided to us by a seed grower. So this was their actual estimate for their actual production estimating spreadsheet that they used for this year. They made it anonymous. They removed the variety names here, but you get a sense of working from the amount of seed that they're contracted to produce for a given variety, and then based on their experience, how much yield they might expect for a given bed. That was the units that they were working on, were in a single, I think they're 100 foot long by 5 foot wide beds, and then they can use that. They can divide the amount that they have contracted, divided by the estimated yield, to then get a sense of how many beds they would need. And then you can see that there's a column here where if that isn't an even number, they have adjusted the numbers up so that, you know, for example, eggplants here shows 1.7 beds needed. They adjusted that up to 2 beds that they're actually going to be planting. Having a chart like this is also helpful in terms of estimating how much revenue they might expect from their farm based on how much they're going to be being paid per pound and what their estimated yields might be for a given seed crop. So once you have an idea of what you're going to grow and how much of it you're want to grow, then the next question is, where on your farm will you grow these seed crops? So again, isolation requirements are a big factor in this. There will be some crops where you can potentially grow multiple varieties of the same species as long as you set up your fields in a way that you have adequate isolation between those varieties within your farm. The other part of mapping your seed crops is going to be following basic standard good farming practices to make a plan to rotate where your families are planted in your farm. So what I mean by family is your crop family, so something like the tomato family versus the bean family versus the grass family versus the cucurbits, versus the squash family, making sure that you're rotating those families so that you're avoiding replanting crops from the same family in the same spot year after year. And ideally, you would have multiple years of rotation before you came back into the same ground with the same with crops in the same family. Finally, something that's a little more specific to seed growing when you're thinking about where to put your crops and what they'll be next to is thinking around irrigation. So one of the critical things with many dry seeded crops is that they really shouldn't be watered overhead once flowering begins. And so you want to make sure to separate crops that might need overhead watering later in the season from dry seeded crops that would be sensitive to that overhead watering and might only be able to be watered with drip or furrow irrigation after flowering. So planning that in advance so that way you don't have some salad mix that really needs to be germinated right next to some of your drying brassica seed, for example, or lettuce seed. So you can take all that information as far as isolation, crop rotation, irrigation requirements, and put that together on a map. And this map allows you to synthesize both the how much space for each crop and the where should each crop go in one place. You can either make these maps on paper or on the computer, and what these maps allow you to do is not only organize your thoughts for this year, but it also provides a real valuable tool for future reference as you can refer back to these maps to continue your crop rotations across multiple years. One of the things that I've heard and have noticed is that when you're making rotation plans with seed crops, it's a good idea to, as much as possible, try and keep them as simple and as flexible as possible. One of the challenges in growing seeds, especially on contract to seed companies, is that many times you might not actually have your final contracts in place until late winter or even early spring. And at that point, you'll really benefit from being able to have as many options as possible in field placement as you scramble to come up with your maps just prior to planting. So the last step of the planting process that I want to talk about today is when to plant. And again, this is a process of working backwards. So there's a couple of critical times in seed production that you want to consider working backwards from when you're thinking about planting time. The first is thinking about flowering time. As Lori pointed out, flowering in early seed development is often one of the most sensitive phases in a seed crop's life cycle, both in terms of having the correct temperatures for that seed crop, having it not be too hot or too cold during flowering, and also for many seed crops, having it be dry during flowering if you have pollinators that need to be flying around. You don't want them to be not flying because it's raining, for example. So I'm not going to be covering a lot of the crop by crop details. Lori covered a little bit of that in general terms for categorizing crops based on their climatic requirements, but we have more resources that we'll point you to at Organic Seed Alliance's website through eOrganic and other places that can give you a little more of the crop by crop specifics. The second critical time point that you want to work backwards from is harvest. So there's a few general limitations to when you're going to need to be done harvesting. You're going to want to be planning your harvest to avoid rains. With dry seeded crops, with wet seeded crops, you tend to have much more flexibility. They're much more forgiving around rainfall events, but with dry seeded crops and some more than others, for example, naked seeds like lettuce, beets, spinach, quinoa, these all are very sensitive to rain at the very end of their maturation process, and so you want to make sure that either if you're in an area that has seasonal fall rains or that you have planned your planting dates so that you're completed harvest and able to bring your crops in prior to planting, or if you're in a place that maybe has rains earlier in the summer, you want to make sure that the seeds are at a point where they can, that the seed crops are at a point where they can handle some of those rains because they're early enough in their maturation process that it won't be as detrimental to them. So the other piece to consider when planning your harvest timing is timing of frost. You want to be thinking especially in terms of frost-sensitive seed crops to have seeds mature and harvested before frost or heavy freezes that could be damaging to them. Based on working backwards, if you have some flexibility in your planting date, what I would recommend is really aim for the best time to plant based on soil temperature and based on a good weather window prior to and after planting. So keep in mind that really a good planting is a key to having a good stand, having minimal weeds, and having a good season. Unlike, say, a CSA or crops for a farmer's market, you often aren't planting multiple successions of a given crop. So you're really not benefiting from pushing an early planting if you don't need it. You want to instead, if you have flexibility, you know, aim for the best planting date for you if you only have a single planting. So finally, I wanted to end my portion of the talk with pointing you to some record-keeping resources. Some of these should be on the eOrganic page that was set up for this webinar, and some of these are on OSA's website as well. So these include OSA's seed crop record sheets. We have a seed crop record sheet and a harvest and handling record sheet that details a lot of the information that you'll want to record about how you grew, how you harvested, how you cleaned your seed crops. We also have the crop plan template that I showed an example of with that spreadsheet of yields and seed quantity demands and market price and maps. So we have an example of that you can use for your seed crop planning, and we also have a field activities template that allows you to record key field activities throughout the season. I would emphasize that keeping good records like these will really help you increase your likelihood of success over time because it will allow you to really learn from your experience and not have to reinvent the wheel and spend a lot of time figuring out things year in and year out. And so using some of these record keeping tools is going to give you a big leg up. With that, I think I'll turn it back over to Allison, Michaela for questions.
Okay, thank you, Jared. We do have some questions coming in. And if you've just joined us, I just want to let everyone know that if you do have a question, you can type it into the question box on your control panel and hit return. I've been getting various requests for different resources, and I just sent the link to the page where we uploaded the resources that Jared was talking about, the spreadsheets, as well as the Organic Seed Alliance climate and seed saving guides. And if you just Google Organic Seed Alliance, you can go to their website, and they have a tremendous amount of information on organic seed production and saving. Also on the eExtension website at extension.org, we also have quite a bit of information, including a seed organic seed resource guide, and so there is a great deal of free information available. Meanwhile, I'm going to get started with the questions here. We had a question about the maturity times for crops, or seed. When you are producing seeds, you're letting them go to a much different and more advanced maturity stage than you would to harvest the crop. Do you want to talk about that a little bit? I think.
Sure. This is Lori. I'll address it. Yes. I am not sure whether the question is related to, like, if you're producing a seed of tomatoes or cucumbers or squash, do you need to let it go any longer into maturity than you would if you're just harvesting those fruits for eating? And for the squashes, the winter squashes, no. The summer squashes, yes. The baseball bat zucchini is the zucchini that you're getting mature seed from, not the nice little one that we're harvesting and selling at the farmer's market. Generally the same with cucumbers. I personally don't have any experience with cucumber seed production, but generally the fruits of cucumbers do get bigger and they turn color. Instead of, they'll go to a green, yellow or brown as the seed is reaching maturity and sizing up inside of those fruits, rather than the greens of the eating maturity. And then in terms of the dry seeded crops, like anything in the peas or the brassicas, anything in pods, those pods are also going to need to go farther than the eating stage. If you're dealing with peas or beans, you want to get the pod to the, it's often called a buckskin stage, where it's yellow and it's drying down, but it's not all the way dry. Oftentimes if you leave seed pods on the plant until they're completely dry, you'll lose a lot of the seed to shattering as you're trying to, as you're going in to harvest the seed. So it is crop dependent, but generally, I guess I would say the answer is generally yes, you're leaving things on the plant or in the fruit longer than you would past our normal eating stage. Tomatoes are the only exception that comes to mind right away. And corn, you want to let corn stay on the cob and start to wrinkle and dry down before you harvest it. Jared or Michaela, you want to jump in?
Could I just add to that a comment that, as I mentioned, we will be covering sequential topics throughout the season, and the September webinar is going to cover timing of harvest, how to recognize when your crop is ready to harvest, so we invite you to join back in for that webinar. Also, if you go to the seed, there's a seed saving for farmers and gardeners guide on OSA's website, and it covers more specific information about timing of maturation and harvest. But really, it's a skill to get to know every individual crop and know exactly what to look for, how to identify the right timing of harvest. And that timing is generally going to mean that some seed on the plant is over mature and some seed is under mature. But your goal is to capture that window of harvest when the greatest majority of the seed is ready for harvest. So Hope that helps.
Okay, I guess sort of in addition to what Lori just said, do any of these resources on your website tell you how long from how many days till the seed is produced?
Jared, Lori, does the seed production guide include maturity timing or length of maturity? I can't remember now.
You mean the on-farm guide for seed saving? I don't believe so. We do have some of that information. Michaela and I helped to write a book in conjunction with Seed Savers Exchange that's primarily focused for gardeners, but the Seed Garden is the name of the book, and that does have some of the more information on a crop-by-crop basis of time to maturity for many of the seed crops. It's going to vary vastly, both based on, you know, some crops in particular are going to vary quite a bit based on where you live and also what variety you're dealing with. So I think Lori could probably speak to this. She has a lot of experience in lettuce, but a crop like that, some varieties are going to be much faster to mature, you know, go from seed to seed than others. And then it's also going to depend on the timing of planting. Different people have different strategies. Some people put the same crops, treat them as an overwintering seed production, whereas other people may plant those in the spring. And so all of those factors kind of confound easy estimates of maturity based on days, and that's one of the reasons why I would say that your experience, you know, in the same way that when I talked about yield, getting that information from your own experience first and you know, and then from local, you know, producers in your area, you know, that is going to be, you know, as you accumulate that knowledge over time, that's going to be one of the resources that you'll have at your disposal to do a better job of planning.
Okay, we're getting a couple of questions about the issue of, you know, I guess Lori and Jared had mentioned how it's a good idea to grow crops that will do well in your climate, but in some cases people want to select seeds that are for other otherwise marginal crops that will do well. You're trying to find varieties that will do better in one's own region. So do you have any comments about that?
Let me mention just again that going back to the webinar series, our next webinar in July is going to cover how to conduct variety trials on your farm. And we often think of variety trials as looking for the best variety for eating and selling qualities and agronomic production, but they're also a great tool for figuring out which varieties you can do seed on in your climate. And there is going to be varietal difference in every species. And, you know, I think it's going to take a little bit of experience to figure out, especially some of those crops that are just marginal for your environment. It's there's a good chance that you'll be able to find some varieties that will produce for you much better than others. And it's also an opportunity to begin to select and develop varieties for your climate. And we often think about our selection and variety improvement and plant breeding, again, for the food crop, but you can also select during that seed production phase and begin to adapt and develop some of the of your varieties for better seed production within your region simply by being cognizant of harvesting those that are earliest or most abundant or have the highest quality seed. Jared and Lori, did you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I'll jump in. This is Lori. Two things that jumped to my mind, well, three immediately. The first answer is absolutely. And the qualification or caveat to that is, you know, if it works, because not everything is going to work, but I always encourage people to play and to try. And the second point being, if the more marginal it is, the less survivorship or success you'll probably have. So if you have something that you're interested in producing seed on and you're either sure or suspicious you're not going to get a whole lot of seed production or a whole lot of success, grow more of it. Because if you have 100 plants and 80% of them die, then you only have 20 plants left. And if you have 200 plants and 80% die, you have 40 plants left. So playing some of that numbers game with moderating what you feel like your success might be. And then the third is to be a little bit careful, because if you are working with a crop that's marginal in terms of season length and you're something is bolting or producing seed early, you may inadvertently be selecting for something that's very bolt sensitive and then doesn't produce well vegetatively because it wants to bolt so fast, because you need it to bolt fast in order to make seed in your season. You can a little bit shoot yourself in the foot by trying to push seed production in that way. And the caveat to that, of course, is if you have something that's a marginal seed producer, you can use those tools and structures to extend your season in order to get a little bit of that bump that you need to reach the maturity you're looking for in those seed crops. And that I'm talking about like greenhouses or hoop houses or some sort of enclosure that give you more heat, more dry.
Okay. Yeah, this is okay. I'll keep it short because I know there's other things. I would just agree with everything that Lori and Michaela had said. I think those were all good points, and more of that will be covered in the trials and breeding webinar that's coming up. Just a real quick point, which is that I think an important thing to consider in this is sort of what's the goal here, and being cognizant of, you know, are you trying to develop a new variety and do some selection and breeding, and that's a great thing to invest in. That is potentially a different thing than if you're trying to be, you know, immediately turning around and treating this as part of your farm income, in which case you want to be much more cautious about jumping into something that's marginal that you may not have experience with and counting on it to have good yields as part of your livelihood.
Okay, I guess we had just one more question about the regional issue. What influence does the site selection have on the regional adaptability of the crop? So for example, if a seed was grown in the Pacific Northwest, will it perform differently because of that in southern areas? So I guess this person is wondering whether growing a crop in a particular area changes the genetics of the seed at all.
Jared, do you want to take that one?
Yep, I'll take that. So the answer is that it depends a little bit. It depends on, often seeds are, you may be actually doing active selection and plant breeding where you're changing the genetics of the crop in more dramatic ways in a given region, but then you may end up producing that seed, taking it out of the region where it's being selected, and you may be actually doing seed production for it in a different region. And so if a seed has just been grown for a single generation in a, say that you have spinach seed that for a spinach had been selected for the Southeast, and that breeding had been happening for a long time and it was a really great variety for the Southeast, and you sent that variety to get seed produced of it for a single year in the Pacific Northwest, and then how much will that seed have changed from a single year of production in the Pacific Northwest? The answer is probably not a lot. It is an area of some debate how much a single season can impact things. There are some kind of there is some new research that suggests that even a single year can have more of an impact depending on what sort of stresses and environmental conditions are occurring in that year of production than might be supposed just from sort of our classical understanding of genetics. But that being said, in general, you know, if a single year of seed production probably won't cause a dramatic change in the, you know, how that variety performs. If on the other hand you're talking about a variety that has been, you know, selected over many generations, say in the Pacific Northwest, then it may or may not be well suited to say the Southeast. Sometimes it's really hard to, as a kind of quick rule of thumb, you could say that, you know, you'd like to look for things that have been selected in the region that you're growing in. But sometimes you end up finding that things that are even coming from another region end up doing well in your region, and it's hard to know that until you do trials.
Okay. Let's see. Do you know of any resources that would have charts for whether weeds can cross with each other? I know your seed saving guide has information on seed varieties crossing. I'm not sure why the person wants it, but do you know of anything like that?
Yeah, the resource that I know for sure has that would be our the Seed Garden book that we published in conjunction with Seed Savers Exchange. I believe that John Navazio's book also has that for the crops that he covered.
Okay, great. Let's see. Do you know of a good pollinator flower for all crops, I guess, to increase seed production?
Yes. This is Lori. I love Phacelia, which is an extremely beneficial insectary crop. It's spelled Phacelia. And you can plant it successively throughout the season, starting in pretty early spring. Depending on how cold you are in winters, you can overwinter it. We overwintered it sort of inadvertently on our farm, and we got down to about 17 degrees. Last year, and the young plant survived and actually are ready for seed harvest right now. It's a great competitor of weeds, I found as well, and it's attractive to beneficial and predatory insects. We work with a farmer, Nash Huber, who grows it every 5 or 7 rows in his brassica production because it really helps with aphid control. And it's got a lot of pollen and a lot of nectar, so it provides resources for a number of wide variety of pollinators. And it's really beautiful, and it also makes a great cut flower.
Okay. Let's see. Do you know of any resources on how to produce potato seeds?
So is the question. So potato seeds, there's two. That can mean one of two things. So it can mean seed potatoes, meaning small potato tubers that are typically used to produce potatoes, or it can mean true potato seed, which is actual true seed that comes from potato flowers. So I don't know if the question asker can clarify, but I do know of there are some research on both out there, and I don't know what the best resource is on producing seed potatoes. I don't know if anyone else on the call does. There's a really nice article I'm looking it up right now on true potato seed production that was written a couple of years ago. I'll see if I can find it.
Okay, we can give you some time to find that, and then we'll share it. Yeah. Does someone else just chime in?
I have a suggestion about the more traditional term of potato seed. Is there any information on Ruth Granger's website at UW Madison. I know that she's doing an organic potato seed project, and I think that that would be a good resource to go look at. You look at UW Madison Organic Potato Project. You may find some information there.
Someone else just chimed in that the University of Maine and Penn State both have a lot of potato seed information. Thank you for that. In the meantime, we have a comment here that someone had some experience growing tomato seeds. And this is a good example of seed trials. I guess they got half or less per acre than they would have of just selling the tomatoes, but they did grow out 60 varieties, and they had virus introduced by whitefly, and they figured out which of the 60 varieties was not killed. So it's a good example of what we were talking about before.
As Lori, as you get into seed production, you will find there are some funny silver linings in thunderclouds like that, where you have an event, whether it's from pest or disease or environmental disaster, that kills off or destroys a bunch of your seed crop, and you will often have some survivors that can turn into a fun project to work with. So sometimes it's a hard lesson, but fun.
Okay. Here's a question about, if you're selling privately or directly to local customers, where can you find resources that would help you to figure out what to charge for seed? Is that going to be addressed in a future webinar?
Well, we do have the last webinar in November will cover some of the economics around seed production and how to engage in contracts for seed production. And I don't have any specific resources to point you to now, but now that the question has been asked, we'll do what we can to integrate it into that future webinar, unless Lori or Jared can think of something at this point. I know there's quite a range, obviously, if you look at packet seed sales. I will also mention that next February at the Organic Ecology Conference, we'll be co-hosting a full day intensive workshop on farm economics, and one component of that will be seed production. And in that session, I know we will be having some producers that work on wholesale and some that work on retail level sharing some of their economic analysis and management tools. So hopefully more information about that in the future.
And my recommendation would be to look at what things are selling for in your area. Look at local seed catalogs, look at local seed racks, and compare whatever you're growing to whatever is being sold around you, but also to look at your economics. How much did it cost you to produce it? How much do you want to make off of it? And look at what kind of price you'd have to get in order for you to either break even or make money off of it.
And don't forget that packing, hand packing packets for racks is part of your enterprise budget expense, right? Make sure you're accounting for all of the phases of costs that are integrated into going direct retail with packets versus a wholesale production contract.
Okay, we have a couple comments about potatoes. We have a listener who recommended Rebsi Fairholm's book called The Lost Art of Potato Breeding, which she says is very layperson friendly in explaining true potato seed production. And then we had a comment that the laboratory stem cell types are a good way to control viruses, but those can't be certified organic potatoes. So if you have any other potato comments, feel free to type them in. Meanwhile, we have a question about whether or not it's possible to harvest the leaves from lettuce and other greens from a seed production crop.
Lori, you want to take that, or would you like me to comment? Well, certainly you can harvest a few leaves off of a plant and it will still go to seed, but the leaves of a plant, the vegetative component, are there to feed the plant's energy, and that's going to result in accumulated energy to go into seed production. So I caution against trying to accomplish a produce harvest and a seed harvest on the same crop. Not to say that it can't be done, but it may be at the cost of your yield or your seed quality. And I think as produce growers move into seed, one of the mental shifts is to really think about that seed crop in the same way that you would put all of your energy into growing a produce crop before you harvest it. And that includes, you know, making sure that it stays weeded and watered and fertilized throughout that full production cycle, because all of that accumulated energy of the vegetative phase is what's feeding the seed production phase of the crop.
Sorry, this is Lori. I was having trouble unmuting myself. I agree with that, and I think another shift in thinking is when you're doing production for seed, you want to leave the nicest plants in the field for seed and eat the ones that aren't nice, which is kind of the opposite of what you're doing for commercial production. So you can go through and whether you're rogueing plants that are off types, or they've got your lettuce has got a little bit of tip burn. So kind of it also depends on what you're harvesting it for. If you're harvesting it for your own consumption and a few leaves for salad at dinner, yeah, it's probably going to be fine. But if you want to go through and cut leaves off and you're trying to do a salad mix for market or sales production, I would not recommend doing that and roguing out the plants that are the less ideal plants and eating those and leaving the ones that are the most robust and strongest and leaving those for your seed production.
Lori, one caveat I would mention is that the spacing for seed crops is generally much larger, especially for the crops that we normally eat in the vegetative phase. So if you think about the radish or lettuce plant, you want 2+ feet, 2 to 3 feet between plants when they're in the seed producing phase. And so you can plant a bed as you would for food production and then harvest as a thinning activity, and during that harvest it gives you also an opportunity to leave the best looking plants to go to seed, so you can do kind of a genetic selection as well as harvest some of those vegetatively mature plants to eat and then leave the best plants at the ideal spacing to go to seed. So but again, keep in mind that you're doing it in a way that's not at the cost of the seed crop, and making sure that you're doing that planning and harvesting in time that the plants that you leave have had an optimum opportunity to grow.
Okay, we have time for one or two more questions. Could your guests address the method of over-ripening and which crops this will increase the seed yield and quality of? You're familiar with that method?
Go ahead, Lori.
I'm guessing this mostly refers to fruit crops, and generally these are the crops that I personally have less seed experience with, but cucumbers and summer squash are the two that come to mind for me, where you want the fruit to get bigger and more mature so you get full mature seed out of them than what we typically harvest as eating stage.
I think often you hear the term over-ripening in the sense of, so also with things like even fruit crops, as you said, but ones that you would typically harvest fully mature, like winter squash, like melons, like peppers, can benefit from after you harvest them, meaning after you're removing them from the vines or the bushes, allowing them to continue to sit and mature off the plants before you process them. And I know that's been fairly common among wet seeded crop producers to allow a certain period of over-ripening. So the goal there is that you're still able to continue a little bit of seed maturation out of the field, and in that case you're balancing allowing for that additional maturity against, you want to halt that process before you end up getting any real significant mold issues or anything like that. But I've often seen people doing that for 3, 4, 5, 6 weeks after they've harvested the plants, taken them out of the field, and just have them continuing to sit before they process them. So part of that is that it improves the seed quality of the crops. The other thing is that it also just is a practical thing that helps make it a little easier, because you can get your seed crop out of the field so that you can turn that field over, put cover crop in, for example, but still allowing your seed crop to continue to mature. And also it's sort of a, those seed crops have a little more wiggle room between a harvest and then processing, so there might be other things that are more time sensitive that need to be threshed and cleaned, and then you can work on your wet seeded crops after that.
Okay, we have one more question. We have about 2 more minutes left or so. So this question is about whether there's a danger in roguing for just visual appearance. What about invisible traits that could be important that we can't see?
Yeah,
that's a great point. Jared, go ahead.
Okay, yeah, I would agree. That's one of the challenges, is how do you select for things if you don't know what you're selecting for? So there's 2 sides to that. One is that you do want to attempt to, if there are things that provide an opportunity for selection, visual traits can be strictly just about appearance, about it being a pretty plant, but it can also be indicators of the vigor of the plants, of how healthy they are, and so making selections based on visual obvious traits when you can see visual obvious differences makes sense. But how do you deal with things that you can't see? One of the safest ways to address that is attempting to preserve diversity so that you can retain some diversity even in things that you don't see. So part of that is maintaining good population sizes so that you continue to have seeds that have been saved from as many plants as possible, so that way you have some genetic diversity both with the visible and invisible traits in there, and you don't accidentally lose it by just selecting a small handful of plants that look really nice but maybe are missing some key traits that are not readily apparent or not readily apparent in that given year. So that would be an important strategy, is just trying to preserve as much diversity as you can by having large population sizes.
And I'll jump in with just a few really quick things to add there. When you are doing selection, some things to keep in mind are, if you see variety for a trait across a whole bunch of plants, that's sort of an indication that there may be genetic difference. If you see only a couple of plants in your field that look really good and the rest, there's not a lot of variation for whatever that trait is, color or size or fruit set, the more variation you see, kind of it's a little more confirmation that you could make a genetic difference by selecting for that. Caveat is, if you see a really beautiful plant in the field, you want to be a little bit suspicious that it may just, we used to call it, it may have a dinosaur poop underneath it. It may just be getting a fertility boost from something in the field. It's not to say you shouldn't save seed from it, but think about the factors that might be contributing to that. And also when you're selecting for visuals, traits, you want to select for a suite of them. If you're just selecting for one or two things, then you're more likely to inadvertently be making genetic selections that you don't want to than if you're selecting for four or five or six things as you're going through the field and visually choosing your favorites.
Okay, we're about to move on to the internship program. Before we do that, Michaela Colley just wanted to make a comment. Do you want to talk about that, Michaela?
Sure. I just wanted to say that, you know, one of our goals at OSA is to develop more resources for this specific topic around planning and managing and record keeping and economic analysis of your seed crops. So if there's anybody in the audience that has some great examples or resources existing or advice to us as we pursue that endeavor, please email them to Jared or Lori. You see their address on the screen. We definitely welcome all input, and you know, obviously we learn the most from the seed producers that are doing this work in the field. I'll also mention that the subsequent webinars will be integrating more seed producers in co-presenting on this webinar series. So in future webinars, please join us again to hear more from those that are out in the field. And then lastly, as we transition to our friends at the MESA program sharing a little more information about how the internship website works, I would invite folks to stay on, not only those who are in the internship program currently, but any of you who are seed producers who have interns on your farm. The intent of this program is to provide some educational structure and resources and medium for forums and communication across seed production farms that are engaged in training interns on their farm. And so if you're just interested in learning a little bit more information about it and considering whether or not you'd like to participate in it in the future, please stick around and listen into what they have to say.
Okay, well, we're going to transition over. Thank you very much, Jared, Lori, and Michaela, for that presentation. We'd like to definitely invite everyone to come the third Tuesday of every month for the rest of the five webinars in this series. So Leah from MESA, I'm going to transfer over the screen controls to you, and you can talk about the internship program.
Great, thank you, Alice. Let's see if this works.
It's a little quiet, so maybe talk a little closer to the mic if you can.
Great. Thanks everyone for being here. My name is Leah Atwood. I'm one of the directors at MESA. And just to reiterate what Michaela was saying, this training program is really designed to support on-farm learning and seed production for both beginning farmers and also help farmers that want to pass on their knowledge to the next generation be as effective as possible with mentorship and education resources. As everyone knows, with increasing consolidation and concentration and ownership in the global seed supply, it's really important that we're supporting small farmers in being able to access these resources, even if you're not connected to a university. So that is in part what this program is designed to do. So this screen here, you can see this is the homepage for the online curriculum that is designed to support the seed internship program. This is the homepage for MESA's general online curriculum, and it's a farm-centered learning community for social change. So if you are participating in the seed training program, you can enroll in this course that supports the on-farm learning. And Natalia is going to walk us through that in a minute, but I wanted to show you what this course is designed to support and how you can utilize the functionality here. So this screen, so here you can see the benefits of participation. So Mesa is also providing a global network of leaders and learners in the food system. And so by joining the online community, you can take part in this horizontal exchange of knowledge and education. In addition to benefiting from the diverse array of experts and experienced producers that are in Organic Seed Alliance's network. So in addition to those, Organic Seed Alliance will also be providing recommendations for contracts with seed companies. And by participating in the course, you'll be able to get a certificate of completion from Organic Seed Alliance and Mesa. And so the requirements for participating, here's a rundown. And the first is you need to be matched with a host farmer. And the program runs 6 months in duration. And one of the links that was on the last slide that OSA reviewed has the link to access a matchmaking site, match.com for seed farmers. And you can go there to be able to connect with farmers that are wanting to host interns. And if you are a farmer that wants to host, you can also review intern applications. So it's a great way to connect with the network in the intern and on-farm learning community, so that you can be matched with someone who is interested in what you're doing and has something to offer that's relevant. So there's an agreement when you participate. And part of, just to clarify too, part of this, you know, it's Mesa or OSA decides on who folks are matched with. This is something that is voluntarily directed, and the site is more just a platform to provide the information. As part of the online activity, there's weekly seed logs that we're actually now it's called a field worksheet activity, and there are monthly readings, there are webinars, as you are participating in, there's also forums and chats, and there's videos. So it's not just, you know, you're not just participating to go after your farming to go and read a 20-page report. It's multimedia and interactive, so to really help learners and educators engage with each other. And then at the end of the program, there's a production report and there's a program evaluation. And then one side note, if you are interested in participating but you are not matched with anyone, please do email us, because you can still participate, and we're very open. Right now, we haven't really discussed, but if you're not matched, you could still take part in the online course, and we can explore how you can complete some of the on-farm assignments in a different iteration. And then, so this slide shows the online platform, and it shows that in the beginning, in the first part, the program requirements, where you can click to access the forms. And we've designed it so that you can complete the assignments online, and you can save them, or you can download them and then upload them, depending on your preference. And then below is the topics and the syllabus and the webinars. So as Michaela was already outlining, this is the itinerary for the monthly modules. So every month there's a module. Crop planning for June, seed trials for July, disease and pests for August, seed harvesting for September, cleaning and records for October, and then contracting, economics, and policy for November. So I'm going to turn it over to Natalia to explain how to register, and thanks for joining us.
Hello, everybody. So for the folks that have registered through apply.mesaprogram.org/OSA, which is our seed farm matching website, you can just go ahead and register right away. And those that don't have a host farm or aren't sure if they are necessarily eligible, I say register. Go ahead and register with this registration process, and you can contact us as well through learn@mesaprogram.org. So to register for the course, go to learn.mesaprogram.org, and you'll see on the homepage on this slide a button at the top that says register. Well, you'll be asked to fill out your registration information. Also, to get to the OSA course, click on courses and certificates at the top in the menu, and that will take you to this page which lists our courses. On the right is the organic seed production course. We also invite you to participate in the Certificate in Applied Agroecology, which is an open course which takes agroecology principles and really grounds them in on-farm learning for interns and host farmers. So you're invited to participate if you would like in that program. So click on organic seed production on the right, and that will take you to the landing page of the organic seed internship course. You'll see a button here that says take this course, and if you are registered, you'll be immediately be able to begin the course. And if you're not registered, it'll take you to a page like this one, where it'll have a login information, and at the bottom it'll say register. So there's a few ways to register. It's pretty straightforward, and if you have any challenges with the registration process, please email me at learn@mesaprogram.org.
So I'd like to thank all of our speakers, Michaela, Jared, Leah, Natalia, and Lori, and hope that you all join us for the rest of the webinars in this series, which are the third Tuesday of every month.